today we're going to talk about these because we... Well, hello there, I'm Green Deane, and welcome to my 104th video here on eattheweeds.com. The topic du jour is Perseas, four of them, three natives and one import.
Our journey starts here, at a local wet spot. Here we find the Perseas palustris. You know, whenever you hear the word palustris, you know there's some damp or wet area involved. And indeed, this tree is called the swamp bay or the swamp red bay. And we know it's wet here, even though we can see some sand, because right here is sawgrass, and sawgrass only grows where it's wet. Sawgrass, by the way, is another edible. Like the first three bays we're going to look at today, the leaves can be used to make a tea or for flavoring. That flavoring can be inside a chicken or in soups or stews or things of that nature. And I have to be careful where I walk here because there are fire ants and poison ivy.
Now some people would ask, well, why show three trees that only produce leaves for tea or for spice? And the answer is, when you don't have tea or spices, these trees are important.
Since I'm dealing with four species, I'm going to kind of itemize as I go along. The palustris is a shrub or tree to about 30 feet. It has large leaves that alternate. They're toothless, evergreen, up to 7 inches long, dark green above. As you can see, usually got some silver underneath. And they also have a bit of hair on the midrib and also on the stem. And when you crush them, you get the distinct smell of bay leaf. First three, they grow from about Maryland south and from to Florida and Maryland west to Texas. Yeah. As far as time of year, the leaves are available year-round. They're an evergreen, at least in the southern range they are. The environment. The environment changes for all three. I might as well mention it now. The palustris likes its feet wet. The next one, we're going to see the bibornia. It likes it neither wet nor dry, although it can tolerate a little wet. And the third one, the humilis, likes it dry. And the fourth one, well, we'll just talk about the fourth one when we get to it. Method of preparation is the same for the first three. You simply take the leaf, put it in your soups or stews, wherever you want to use it, or part of it, and also you simply crush it up and put it in hot water to make a tea.
Now let's drive about 15 miles from here and take a look at the second Perseas. But before we do that, let's take a look at something that crossed my path on the way here today. I can find Perseas in many places other than here. But these are growing in the perfect spot. Not too wet, not too dry. The bibornia can grow to 70 feet, about twice as high as the swamp bay. It's much larger around, and the leaves are slightly shorter, about 3 or 4 inches. They curl a bit on the edge, and they're waxy underneath. And of course, when you crush them, they're bay, but smell. But look at the size of this one here. Now, if I can just put my hand on this thing, this is a huge, you saw, it's gonna be a good 2 feet through. This is a Perseas bibornia. It looks very similar to the palustris we just saw, except its twigs are not as hairy. And along the midriff, there are no fine hairs. It's called a red bay because if you work the wood, it ends up with a nice red luster to it and is used often in finishing for ships and inside homes and things like that. If you go to my video on Turtle Mound, there I also talk about a Perseas bibornia. It's halfway up the Turtle Mound. Turtle Mound is 80 feet high, and of course the bottom is at sea level, and wouldn't you know it, that Perseas has put itself right in the middle, about 40 feet up. You know. Now that we've covered two of our bays, the palustris and the bibornia, we have two down and two to go. So let's head off and look at the third one. This is a scrub area, dry scrub. The only water it gets is rain, and here's where we find the Perseas humilis, or the scrub bay. It's also called the silk bay. Humilis is also where we get the word. Humilis means low growing, low, small. It's also where we get the word humility in English. If you happen to find a Perseas humilis. Don't harvest from it too much because it's an endangered species. In fact, I'll legally cover myself and say don't harvest from it. It's an endangered species. As I said, the scrub bay is also called the silk bay. It's called a silk bay because you look on the other side of these leaves, they're copper colored, not silver colored. See that? Very coppery. Whereas the other two we looked at today were silver underneath. As the tree gets older, it loses the copper color underneath, because that's actually created by little tiny hairs. So the older leaves won't have the copper color. Unlike your other bays, the scrub bay is pretty rare, and you're only going to find it on the central peninsula of Florida. So we're not going to spend too much time on it, because very few people will ever get a chance to see it. I had to bike a few miles to get to this Perseas, even though it's right near a highway. There's no easy way to get here except by wheels, so I drove several miles and biked several miles. And I'll tell you what, my foot is still itching from that fire ant bite I got earlier. Before we go look at the fourth Perseas, let's just do a quick rundown of the three we've seen so far. Identification. The palustris is a shrub to 30 feet. The bibornia grows to several feet high, around and 70 feet high. And the humilis, very, very small. On the first two, you have large green leaves that are silver on the bottom, and when you crush them, you smell bay leaf. On this one, you have small leaves that are green on the top and copper colored on the bottom, but when you crush it, you'll smell the bay also. Time of year, all year round, they're evergreens in most of their range, at least they are in the southern range. Environment, they like three different environments. The palustris likes its feet wet, the humilis likes it very dry, and the bibornia likes it in between. Although we can also, and it also, since it can exchange its range a bit more than the other two, you'll find the bibornia more than the other two. And method of preparation is the same for all three. You take the leaf, put it in some tea, crush it and put it in some hot water to make a tea, or you put it in soups. Well, now that I've talked about three of the four Perseas, let's go talk about the fourth one, kind of separately. It's called Perseas americana, or you know it as the avocado. So, can you use the avocado leaf like any other Perseas leaves? Well, the answer is yes and no. You can only use the avocado leaf that's called the germifolia. And now, how do you have that? Well, it'll smell like licorice or anise. And then that's the only one you can use. And then sparingly, because it's a lot stronger than the other Perseas, and it has other elements as well. Always check with your local expert first. Here's what I find interesting. The Aztecs used to wrap food in the avocado leaf and cook it, using the leaf for flavor. They called food cooked this way tamales. Now you know where the name came from and the cooking style. Incidentally, the word avocado is a corruption of an Aztec word for one of two things that only males have. Oddly, the word orchid means the same thing for the same reason. Personally, I think people in the past who named plant parts had too much time on their hands, or something else in their minds. One thing you may not know is that all of the avocado, leaf to fruit to seed, is toxic to many animals. In fact, let's take some time out and discuss that. When I say time out, I mean time out. As a forager, I've heard over the years all kinds of nonsense about how you can tell what to eat from watching animals. Don't bet your life on it. Squirrels can eat strychnine, birds can eat arsenic, deer can eat poison ivy, and the dog's motto is, I can always throw it up later. The only animal you can safely watch and imitate is me and thee, and maybe a monkey. But even monkeys can eat some things that perhaps we should avoid. There are no shortcuts. Learn what's edible. We now return to our video, currently in progress. Avocados can kill cats, dogs, cows, goats, rabbits, rats, birds, fish, and horses. You know, that it can kill goats is rather interesting. Goats are kind of like the pig of the plant world. They usually can eat things that other animals can't, but apparently not avocados. Also, I want to mention that the small fruit on the native Perseas we saw earlier, they're not edible by anyone or anything either. Thanks for joining me on my 104th video, this time about the Perseas, the palustris, bibornia, humilis, and americana, germifolia. Try saying those 10 times fast. If you want to know more about them, you can go to eattheweeds.com and look them up in my archives. I have about 600 plants there, by the way. So until next time, this is Green Deane. I want you to think green, eat green, and live green too. Toodles.